Wonderful to worship with you. God is good. There it is. Left side is ruling with that. God is good. They clap louder too. God is good. Not bad, not bad. Open your bulletins with me for just a moment if you would. Our precious Tony Berg is away with his wife Judy this weekend, investing in their marriage. Praise God. A lot of our ladies are at the conference as well. So keep them in prayer as they come home this afternoon. I am so looking forward to seeing my wife. Yeah, you know, brother, you know where I was going with that, didn't you? And so they'll be back late this afternoon, excited to have our wives come home. But there's a number of exciting things, as always, coming up. Our men's conference, May 16th, we need you to sign up in the foyer so we can have an idea of how many are going to attend. We're going to meet here at the church, and it's local in Sacramento, praise God, and so we'll carpool over. Sign up in the foyer. We'll keep you in the loop as far as all the details are concerned. Our men and women study. Pause, in and out. Batteries. We're just blessed that the screens work today. Are they still working? That's great. Praise the Lord. Things happen when you talk about important subjects from the Scripture, I'll tell you. Amen? But again, that's coming up May 12th. Our men's and women's monthly Bible study here at 7 o'clock. And then lastly, Primetimers, our 50-plus ministry. Season saints coming together, seeking the Lord and seeing how they can be used of God. May 23rd, Saturday, 6 to 8. Bring someone with you. It's a great opportunity to invite a friend to come. Amen. Well, all that being said, I'm excited today. That's not new, I know, but I'm really excited today because, as we've been announcing, we're going to start a three-week series. I don't know, maybe we'll do four, you know, it's Holy Spirit stuff. So, but at least at this point, we're planning on doing a three-week series on the person and work of the Holy Spirit. Think this through for just a moment for those that maybe don't know or are unaware, and in thinking about this morning, a little bit. I think so many Christians, we hear all the cliches. We hear talk about the Holy Spirit, and a lot of that comes from the experiences that others have had, and that's nice, right? But give me Scripture. Amen? Like, what you think about the Holy Spirit, or the things people say, or the stuff that they declare, that's all great. But give me Scripture. Give me the stuff that God says about Himself, about the Holy Spirit. That will equip me to develop a personal relationship with Him. That'll afford me the opportunity to partner up with Him in this Christian life. Christian life is hard, isn't it? I mean, let's be real, it's not, but it is. In fact, the Christian life in so many ways is impossible for us to live. To live as Christ, to die as gain, Paul said, that's impossible for you. And for me, if not for the presence, the partnership, the empowering of the Holy Spirit. And so I'm excited. I hope you are too. Come on, brother. Why don't you welcome up Pastor George?
Well, Pastor Aaron, he just preached it. I could just sit down. It's amazing. It's amazing. He's so eloquent. And I'm not, but I'm glad to say that I am his pastor, though he outpreaches me. So anyhow, welcome. Pastor Ernest asked if I would share a little bit about the Holy Spirit, and I want to do that. Thank you for being here. It's a subject, I think, that Pastor Aaron alluded to. There's a lot of misunderstanding. There's a lot of fear when we discuss and talk about the Holy Spirit. I titled this, A Friendship That Can Change Your Life. And I really truly believe that God wants a relationship. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit wants a relationship with every one of us. I want to just use an illustration. 42 years ago this month, Shar and I exchanged our I do's. Yeah, 42 years. Yeah, we never thought about divorce, but we thought about killing each other. So, just kidding. It's been a relationship that's obviously changed my life in so many ways. And together we've learned to build and maintain a loving, lasting love. I believe that our marriage has enriched each other's existence. I know being with Shar has changed my life in such a great way. But it was a relationship that nearly never really came about. It was touch and go there for a while because Char really did not think much of me. There was so much about me that she assumed she knew, but she was wrong. She thought because I lived with a guy and I had shaggy hair back then that I was not interested in women. A misconception on her part. There were other misconceptions that she had about me that every time that I would ask her out, she would say, nope, 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 nope. And then finally, a friend, and I need to underscore that, a friend encouraged her to take a chance on me. And how I am so thankful for that woman who encouraged Char to open up her eye to realize how blessed she would be to have me in her life, you know. In Acts 1, 4, and 5, we see here after his death and resurrection, Jesus tells his disciples to stay in Jerusalem and wait for the Holy Spirit. That is so profound, you know, in just that thought alone, that here the Lord is resurrected, and all of a sudden he wants to talk about the Holy Spirit. And as this woman really encouraged Char to have a relationship with me, and the benefit that we would have being together is what we see here, that Jesus wants to introduce the Holy Spirit to his disciples to be their special friend, that they would have a relationship that would radically, radically enhance their existence and change the world as they knew it at that time, and their world for sure. Real friendship with the Holy Spirit can change our life. And as Pastor Aaron alluded to earlier, the Christian life is a divine life. We can't live it in our own strength. The Bible tells us it's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit. And so we realize if we're struggling today in our Christian life, we're always defeated. You know, that we never seem to have any joy. We're not a witness. We just somehow just struggling to make ends meet, spiritually speaking, then it's indicative that's probably that we're not in tune with the Holy Spirit. So we want to talk about that because it changed so many people's lives as we read in the scripture, particularly one of the worst enemies of the church, Saul of Tarsus, who one day on the road to Damascus had this experience with God and the Holy Spirit and it radically changed his life. A man who almost was like a slave trader, if you would, that he would arrest men and women because of their faith, and he would haul them into jail, disrupting family lives. A man who despised Christ, hated this Christian faith, who was in contact with God on that Damascus road, and all of a sudden now he's a believer and one of the greatest historians and obviously the greatest theologian the Bible has ever known. What happened? He had an encounter with the Lord and with the Holy Spirit. And he wanted to make sure that his other disciples, that everyone he came in contact with, knew the Holy Spirit also. As we read in 1 Corinthians, he just talks so much about the Holy Spirit. Him as a person, the gifts that he brings, the transformation that can take place in our life. He's just so consumed in that he just wants everyone, to have this experience. So in Acts 19, 1 through 2, read now the New Living Translation. We alluded to this last time when I was with you, just talking about this series. When Apollos was in Corinth, and Apollos, he was a dynamo. He was like Pastor Aaron. I mean, he was eloquent. He could really speak. And we realize that Paul traveled through the interior regions until he reached Ephesus on the coast, where he found several believers. And notice what he says here. You know, like, you know, how's things going? No. You know, what's happening in your life? No. You know, how's the kids? Got a job? How's your faith? No, he says this, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? Now, why would he say that? I think it underscores the importance that Paul saw that the Holy Spirit can have in each and every one of our lives. He saw the significance that the Holy Spirit really makes a difference in a believer's life. Have you received the Holy Spirit when you believed? He asked them. It's a great question. We should be able to ask each other, have we received the Holy Spirit when we believed? And we'll talk about that because there's great controversy there. When do we receive the Holy Spirit? Do we receive it? You know, when we ask Jesus into our life, is it the second work of grace? We'll talk about that probably next week or the following week. But he asked them, and they said, no. They replied, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. They were ignorant regarding the personage of the Holy Spirit. They had no idea, no concept. They didn't understand the Trinity, that in the nature of God, there's three persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Three but one. Co-equal, co-eternal, but one. Not three gods, one God. The triunity, the Godhead. They had no idea. They were young in the faith. They were just believers. They just accepted Jesus. But there was more that Paul wanted for their life, because he realized during this time there was severe persecution taking place around the world, particularly in this part of the country. He was concerned about them standing against the wiles of the enemy, the devil who goes about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. He was concerned that they would stand in their faith, that they'll be bold in their witness, and if need be, they would die with the power of God in their lives. Don't even know there's a Holy Spirit. Many Christians do not understand the Holy Spirit, or how to experience him in their daily lives. This is what we see here. People often struggle in their understanding. Who is the Holy Spirit? Is he a wind? Is he energy? Is he a force? Is he a person? Who is he? And so many believers struggle with this thought about the Holy Spirit. And the lack of knowledge regarding the Holy Spirit and his ministry in the life of believers is a great concern for Pastor Aaron, as it is for me also, too. Because whatever God has for me, I want. And whatever can enhance my relationship with him and my love for my wife and my children and the love for the world is important. I did two funerals this last week. And one of the things I realized, and I've shared this before, it's one thing to live well, it's another thing to die well. The scripture tells us it's better to go to a funeral than it is to a wedding. There's just something about the end of our life and how we lived it that's significant to God. We could give our whole life to live a right way. In the last moments, we can ruin our name and our integrity. And that's why the Bible loses that. Think about that, that one day you're going to die. Do you want to die well? Do you want to die well with great integrity and honor? That you didn't bring a reproach upon your family, your family's name, upon God and the church. And as I look at this, I realize in my own life, that's what I crave, to die well. That I didn't shame God. I didn't shame my wife, my children. I didn't shame the church. And that is a struggle, and it's hard, because the enemy battles me every day in regards of my weaknesses in my life. Always wants to take me out. Always wants to take me out, wants to sideline me, quiet my voice, rob me of my reputation and my influence in people's lives. That's why we're so concerned about us knowing and having a relationship with the Holy Spirit, because if we have any hope to die well with dignity and honor, it's going to be the help of the Holy Spirit in our life. So there's so much misconception, so much misunderstanding regarding the Holy Spirit. In fact, many Christians are afraid of the Holy Spirit. And there's probably good reasons why. It's because there's a group of people who behave, as Pastor Aaron alluded to, that they say they have this experience with the Holy Spirit, but it's not in line with the Bible. We're not talking about just sheer emotionalism, but there is emotions in our life with God. We're not talking about being crazy charismaniacs. You know, we're talking about having a biblical balance of who he is and the role of the Holy Spirit in our life. I was raised in a Greek Orthodox church. I didn't know much about the Holy Spirit, and then I got saved in a heavy, wild, crazy Pentecostal church that we were swinging on the on the, what do you call it, the chandelier, well, I can't ever pronounce it now. Thank you. I can't get it in my mind right now. But that's how wild we were, you know, just rolling on the floor, you know, and I finally came to a place that I realized, you know what, I just need balance in my life. From a traditional church to a crazy church, I needed balance, and that's where I found Calvary Chapel. Because they taught me, too much word you dry up, too much spirit you blow up, and a combination of both, you grow up. Isn't that good? Huh? Yeah. And that's what Calvary's all about. It's right in the middle between a traditional church and a wild church. Because there are a lot of people in traditional churches who love the word, and the emphasis is on the word in a lot of these traditional churches, whether it be Baptist or somewhat like that. We love those, brother. They're given of the word. But their misconception of the Holy Spirit, maybe because of the charismatic movement, causes them to be afraid to get emotional or allow the Holy Spirit any expression in their midst. So they're really word-only people. And on the other side of the pendulum, there's the charismaniacs who love the Holy Spirit, love his ministry, love his presence, love the joy that he brings to life and the power, but there are many there who just feel like, you know what, we just need some balance, we need some word in our life. Word heavy here, spirit heavy there. What's going to happen? Well, that's where we see Calvary Chapel, because they're word and spirit balanced, and it's so important to me that you understand that. The Holy Spirit is a divisive topic in many churches today. Battle lines have been drawn between churches and denominations because of the Holy Spirit. And for many, he is a God many have never known because of the misconceptions and the fear, a God that many have never known. I want to use an illustration to help understand this point here. Some years back, I received a phone call from my sister informing me that I had a half-brother, a brother that I never knew. You know, and she thought I'd be all giddy and happy about it. It was one of the worst experiences of my life because I didn't know really who I was. I thought I was my father's youngest and only son. I thought I was my sister's only brother. And all of a sudden, I found out that there's someone else now in my family, and I didn't know where I fit in the pecking order. No longer why I was the young brother or the youngest son, I was the middle child. I never experienced that before. And all of a sudden, I began to question what I was all about. It was emotional, to say the least, to discover that there was a family member that I never knew I had. I'm talking about never knowing we had the Holy Spirit for many people, never experiencing that God in their life. He was a brother, truly, from another mother. But we didn't have the opportunity to talk much about him, particularly around my mother, because she realized her husband, my dad, an adulterous relationship that produced an offspring. He was an embarrassment to my mother, as the Holy Spirit is embarrassment to many people in the church today. Maybe because of the abuse, maybe because of not the balanced teaching of the Holy Spirit. And sadly, my connection with my half-brother has become almost neglected, a neglected relationship. We don't talk much, we don't spend time together. And the reality is this, that he used to be a preacher too. And I bring this out because many people are embarrassed of a family member. Maybe you just soon discovered recently a child in your life, or, you know, or whatever it might be, a brother, a sister, you know, or something, and all of a sudden you're shocked. Maybe you're excited about it. I don't know. But as we think about this, I want to just use this whole thought here. Here is a brother in my life that I've had an experience with. Is there a part of the Trinity that people, maybe because of embarrassment or out of abuse or out of fear or misconception or misunderstanding, has not had an experience with the Holy Spirit? I think it's a great illustration, because I think many people today treat the Holy Spirit as a half-brother or a step-brother of the Trinity, an insignificant family member of the Godhead. My father, understood the Father in the Godhead, but would not accept the Son. He had a hard time wrapping his mind around the very fact, why would God want to have a son and send him to die for us? We've got the Father, what else do we want? Many people say we have the Father and we have the Son. Why do we need the Holy Spirit? Such churches may say much about Jesus, but they say so little about the Holy Spirit. Do I have your attention today? I hope I do. I'm hoping that you're hearing me today. Most Christians study the personage of the Father, his nature. Many study the personage of the Son, but only a few seem to really speak about the Holy Spirit. Francis Chan wrote a book called The Forgotten God. I encourage you to download that on Kindle. It's about $3 or $4. It's really cheap. He does a good job there. He's not a charismaniac, nor is he just evangelical. He realizes there's something there. And the title of the book is The Forgotten God, Speaking of the Holy Spirit, Reversing Our Tragic Neglect of the Holy Spirit. Hey, somebody said if the Holy Spirit was taken out of the church today, the church will still exist. Do you understand what I'm saying? That so many people feel like we don't need the Holy Spirit in our life. We got a cutesy worship team that's extremely, extremely talented. We got a charismatic leader that can attract crowds. Why do we need the Holy Spirit? And the reality is we have to say, yeah, that seems to be true today. Many churches are doing a bang-up job drawing the crowds from all over the community. But there's no Holy Spirit. It's emotions, it's hype in some aspects, it's cute, it's comforting, it's refreshing, it's entertaining. But there's no life change in the members. No life change. Reversing the tragic neglect of the Holy Spirit. We don't want to see that here. Because there are so many people who think little of the Holy Spirit today. And I know that's Pastor Aaron's desire to reverse the neglect of the Holy Spirit. He wants to be so much more in our life. He wants us to embrace him and enhance our experience with God and the Godhead. The promise of Jesus Christ to send the Holy Spirit is the high point in the Gospel of John. As we go through the Gospel of John, particularly some of those passages we find out in some of the chapters in 12 and 14 and 16, it was the high point of Jesus to talk about the Holy Spirit. Let's look at this for a moment. He says, I pray the Father, said the Lord Jesus, and he shall give you another comforter. In the Greek, that means parakletos, meaning one called alongside, a friend, a supporter, an encourager, that he may abide with you forever. That's John 14, 16, that he may abide with you forever. Now, many of us would probably choose a visible Jesus Christ over an invisible spirit. But Jesus knew that he was leaving. And he said, you're going to need another comforter. I've been with you for 3.5 years, but he's going to be with you forever, forever, forever. And I think that's really important. We want to understand that. So Jesus wants to introduce his disciples to this new wonderful friend, the Holy Spirit. His desire is to be in relationship with you is what Jesus is really telling them. Now, Holy Spirit is so critical in the life of a believer. We need that power and that freedom in our life. It helps us to draw closer to God, to Jesus. It deepens our intimacy with the Lord. He's the very core of the believer's life, according to Jesus and according to Paul. He is essential to our life if we want to be victorious. If we want to know the joy of the Lord, to really know that. If we want to really become spiritually mature, if we really want to improve our spiritual health, we need the Holy Spirit. We need more of his power in our life. We do. We're living in difficult days, we need power to stand strong in God and overcome the work of our flesh, the wiles of the enemy, and the world that's going in the opposite direction. He helps us to support our spiritual progress. He helps us to provide spiritual growth and maturity in our Christian life, the Holy Spirit. He's the one who molds us into the very image and likeness of Jesus Christ. We just came back from Half Moon Bay, my wife and I. We spent, I think, Sunday night, Monday, Tuesday there, Wednesday. And we returned back on Thursday. We love being at Half Moon Bay, and I don't want you to like it because there's only about 20 spots there, and if you like it, then we're going to argue over who's going to get that spot next time I want to go. So just forget about what I told you about that state beach at Half Moon Bay. But what we enjoy about it is that every morning I like to get up and build a fire. There's just something about a campfire. Do I get an amen out of that? You know, and some hot chocolate, right? Char drinks tea. Thank you, brother. Come on. Yeah. Hot chocolate's great. And I just love the fact of being able to do that there. So we end up buying some kindling wood, some hardwood, and loaded the car, and, you know, we couldn't wait to start the first fire. You realize that fire was always treated as a gift from the gods. And I think it's a gift from our God. Fire helped early man to cook food, provide warmth, and keep away wild animals. And I think about that, I see that there's a sense of nourishment there to be able to cook food, to keep warm. There's comfort there, and to keep the enemy at bay. There's protection there. A fire. The Bible says our God is a consuming fire to nurture us, to comfort us, to protect us. The fire's triangle is a simple model for understanding the necessity of the ingredients that go in to make a fire, and you see it there. This triangle illustrates the three elements of fire that needs to be ignited if a fire is going to start. What do we need? We need heat, we need fuel, and we need oxygen. A fire naturally occurs when the elements are presented and combined in the right mixture. And this is so important for me, because a fire can be prevented or extinguished or removed, if you would, if one of these elements are removed. If we don't have the heat, we're not going to have fire. If we don't have fuel, we're not going to have fire. If we're not going to have oxygen, we'll not have a fire. Here's the key. Without one of these elements, a fire cannot start or continue. What am I alluding to? Stay with me. Without significant heat, a fire cannot begin. It can't continue. Without fuel, it'll stop. And this is what's really important. Without sufficient oxygen, air. Jesus told his disciples in John 14, in fact, he said, "Receive ye the Holy Spirit," and he breathed on him oxygen. A fire cannot begin and it cannot continue. By depriving a fire of air, it'll be extinguished. And many of us know that. We throw water on the fire. We can throw a fire blanket on the fire. And I think these are great examples of us really, 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 really somehow extinguishing the breath of the Holy Spirit in our lives. You know, we've done it before, I think. Maybe we've done it at school under a class at science or something, a science project, but we can take a small candle in an empty glass and put the glass on top of the candle. And then what happens? We know the fire stops. By depriving the Spirit in our life, the fire of our witness for Christ is extinguished. That's what's really important in Acts 1:8. "And when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you shall be able to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and in the othermost parts of the world." If we're having a struggle in our lives, being a witness, we need to ask ourselves that somehow have we really snuffed out the Holy Spirit? Is his breath still able to enter into our being, our spiritual life? Are we breathing in the breath of the Holy Spirit? Are we doing that? The Bible says don't quench the Spirit. That's in 1 Thessalonians. We'll look at that. Don't put out the Spirit's fire within you. Don't quench it. If we do, there's no spiritual combustion. There's no burning. There's no ignition. There's no fire. There's no liftoff. Houston, we have a liftoff. There's no liftoff without it. We're not living in the power of the Holy Spirit. And I know that's not what you want. I know that every one of us want all that God has for us, don't we? We want to be great witnesses. We want to see our friends and our families come to Christ. We don't want to kowtow. We don't want to bend in fear. We want to be bold as lions for Jesus. We don't want to put out that fire. We don't want to be fireless believers, do we? No. We love fires, don't we? We always love to watch a fire. In fact, when I was making that fire the other day in Half Moon Bay and I had my camera there, I must have shot 8 or 10 pictures of the fire. I love fires. We love it. We like to watch houses burn down, don't we? We like to see fields on fire. I know it's not good, but come on, we do. There's just something about it. We like to see a Christian on fire. We like to watch him burn for God, right? Well, a few of us do anyhow. Yeah. Man, that guy's on fire. Wow. And we're nurtured by that. We're comforted by that. We're empowered by that. No spiritual nourishment, no comfort, no protection, forget it. We need the wind of the Holy Spirit. So I want to look at another thought here. We talked about the triangle of fire. Let's talk about the triangle of God and bring it to a close if we can. God is commonly represented as a triangle. Look up on the webpage, the triangle of God. You'll see that there. And I want you to know something. It was a Trinitarian symbol that was used by the early church, and it was the only one used for a long time by the early church, this triangle of God. It was used in the catacombs on the graves. They were used as grave markers. This triangle is highly Christian in meaning. And in religious context, it really underscores the importance of what I just told you about fire. We need fuel, we need heat, we need oxygen in order to have a fire. And we're going to look at and realize that that is such a great type of the Holy Spirit and God the Son and God the Father. Their three are one. I see the Father as heat. I see Jesus as fuel. And I see the Holy Spirit as the breath, the wind of God. And without them together, the Trinity, then we don't see the ignitement of God in our lives. And that's why it's so important that we understand the Trinity, and we might spend some time dealing with that. But he's not a lesser God, the Holy Spirit. He's not a half-brother to Jesus Christ or a step-brother. He is God the Holy Spirit. And remember what I said, God is a consuming fire, right? There's the ingredients for fire, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. When God revealed himself to Moses, how did he reveal himself? In a burning what? Fire in a burning bush. Think about that. And I think that's so important. Without the Holy Spirit, we smother the fire of God within our lives. The energy of God, the power of God, it's dissipated. We need the Holy Spirit. We need to spend time to understand who he is and how we can be empowered by him. We need to know the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. 1 Thessalonians 5:19, I alluded to that earlier. Do not quench the Spirit. Covering a fire with a fire blanket removes the oxygen. We don't want to do that. We can't deny it. We don't want to restrict it. We don't want to say, Holy Spirit, you're not welcomed here. I've been in churches where he wasn't welcome. And I'm sure you have in the past too. He's not welcome. We don't want any mess here. We don't want you to have any freedom. We're extremely paranoid what might happen if we give you freedom in our church. People might act weird. They might start talking in tongues. They might start prophesying. They might start laying hands on. We don't want any of that. We don't want to draw the crowds in and all of a sudden talk about the Holy Spirit and draw them out. A lot of people, as I alluded to earlier, they don't want the Holy Spirit. It might get messy. And on the day of Pentecost, it got really messy in Jerusalem. You guys are drunk. Remember that? They're out of your mind. I'm sure many of them thought, can we just bottle that up and put it away and hide it? That was the birth of the church. The church was birthed in fire. I'll baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire, Jesus said. Now, you could take that another way, but I like to think that's just what he was saying, that he wants to baptize us in fire that we would ignite for God and be witnesses that would help us at work, at play, at home, to live right and to finally die right. We want to activate his presence in our life, don't we? Yes, George, we do, we do. We want to activate, we want to be ignited in God. Yeah, we do. We want to say, Holy Spirit, you're welcome here. We're welcomed here, Holy Spirit. People lost loved ones here. People are diagnosed with cancer here. People are struggling in their finances here. People are having a hard time living for God here. What do we need? We don't need entertainment. We need fire. We need fire. A balanced fire, because fire can be dangerous, can it? It can be very destructive, but it can be very beneficial, and that's why we're Calvary Chapel, and we'll talk a little bit more about that balance. Holy Spirit, you're welcome here. So next week, we want to learn a little bit more about the Holy Spirit and how he works in the believer's life. So I want to thank you for being here today, and I just want to just close in prayer and say, Father, we just want you to pour out your Spirit upon us as individuals and as a church. And we want to come to the place in our life that if we're not ignited for you, if our witness has been extinguished, that we would get a fresh breath of you in our life. As we sang today, it's your breath in our hearts, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs that causes us to praise you. It's your breath in our being that causes us to walk uprightly before you. It's your breath that causes us to go the extra mile. It's your breath in us that causes us to be able to forgive others. It's your breath that transforms our life and forms us in the image and likeness of Christ. And we just want the Holy Spirit. So Holy Spirit, we welcome you. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. We welcome you in our hearts, in our lives. We just thank you for what you're going to do in our hearts, in our lives, and in this church in the days and weeks that lie ahead. Amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Trinity now. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. The fire of God. God bless you. If you need prayer, come on up. Pastors are here. Leaders are here. You want to say anything else, Pastor Aaron? Nothing left to say. God bless you. One couple got up and left, but that's usually what happens. Some two or three. God bless you. Get on fire, huh? Oh, okay, good. Get on fire. Get on fire. If you want prayer, come on up. There's enough.